Well, I think I'll get started. Thanks a whole bunch for coming during the lunch hour. Again, my name is Anna Russell. I'm from the University of San Diego. I'm going to be talking about an interesting way in which we can provide a collaboration to students, teachers, people that you work with, especially in a law school setting. And I wasn't quite sure how my presentation was going to fit in with the CALI conference, but I heard the keynote speakers talk, and I think this is a great way to provide collaboration and sort of a practical experience in a law school environment. Before I start, I want to show that I do have a handout. It looks like this, and it's at the front of the room. So it's just sort of my talk in a nutshell and sort of the different players about access to information that I'm going to be talking about through my presentation. If you do find that you want it, it's at the front of the room. Okay. Okay, so I even my title slide, I think, is instructive about how I think about legislative advocacy, because, you know, we're passionate, we're excited, but we also do it sort of with a friendly face. So I'm going to be talking about why me, why are you interested in it, and why now in particular? Why wouldn't I have thought to talk about this 5 years ago? There's current sort of the standard library legislative advocacy causes that I think we're all familiar with. But then I want to talk about making our law library voices heard in new ways, because I am a law librarian. And then I'm going to give a description of current efforts around saving government data, and then lessons and thoughts for future advocacy events. So why me? I was an officer in the Navy, so I've worked for the Department of Defense. I've also worked for the Department of Justice. I'm at a law school, and I'm also part of the Government Relations Committee, so I'm really interested in government information, and I understand how the creators of government information do it, and often they're very busy, they have time frames, and they may not have a standard for metadata or a standard for saving their data, but they acknowledge that it's really important. And then I figure folks that are coming to hear this type of presentation are interested in access to justice, interested in legal information, preserving it, providing it to the public or students or some other type of group that you're trying to help. And then there is an elephant in the room that I think makes this particularly of value now, more so than it might have been in prior administrations. So a quick reminder about what, if you think of library advocacy or legal library advocacy, these are typical causes. So AALL is really interested in making sure that important groups get funded. The Institute of Museum and Library Services is slashed in the president's budget. The Legal Services Corporation is slashed in the president's budget. So there's advocacy to make sure that that doesn't pass Congress. AALL opposes any weakening of the resources and authorities for the Copyright Office. Access to information, of course, is very important. Making PACER and CRS reports free to the public. AALL is very much behind that. Protecting net neutrality. This is very, very current. In July, they're going to be, I think that's the deadline for comments on the FCC's proposed rulemaking regulations. Update, always updating privacy laws, seeing how that evolves. And then UELMA. Is everybody familiar with UELMA? That's been a really big advocacy push on the law library side, and that's something we're really strong at. So when I talk about law library advocacy, I think that what might come to mind for people is making sure that they stay in their lane and understanding sort of what should be the role of the information professional when they're talking about advocacy, and what's outside of our lane. So I think a couple big buckets that help to narrow the scope of that question are that when I talk about librarian advocacy, I'm certainly not talking about the practice of law. We are always cognizant that the practice of law means providing legal advice or services to another, and these are in every state bar rules of ethics or some other area to make sure that you're not providing the practice of law. But I think when I'm talking about collaborative efforts to make information available, it's really not that's inside our scope, and the practice of law would be outside of it. Another area, there was a talk yesterday about making sure to provide knowledge, and they talked about activism, and sometimes advocacy is thought of as activism, but I really don't think that information professionals, librarians, are really ready to be activists. When I think of activism, I think about this definition of it, where it's talking about supporting or opposing one side of a controversial issue. Sure, at home we might be like that, but when we're at work, we're very much into gathering the facts, gathering information. So when I talk about advocacy, I'm not talking about activism. So what am I talking about when I talk about advocacy? What is the lane there? Well, I think in my mind there was a standard type and there's a new type. So the standard type is what you're familiar with and whether you've done it or not. It's calling a legislator, it's writing an email, it's going to a town hall meeting, and it's sort of a one-on-one. It's an individual concern that hurts your profession or helps your profession, but you're doing it for yourself to help out. This new type of advocacy that I'm really excited about is this collaborative group effort where you're working together, and that's not something that at least librarians have really been on the forefront of. So the forefront, I think, that we can really play a role in is advocates for information. So what I think is exciting in other realms, especially with students, is sort of the idea of crowdsourcing group action efforts and sort of a hackathon. I've always, always, always wanted to do a hackathon, but I don't have computer science skills, nor do I have the subject matter that would really integrate well with a hackathon, creating applications or something. But with this concept of advocates for information, I can get as close as I think I could potentially. So I have a clip about the start of this notion about social collaborative advocacy for information. And it's about the end of term project. Can people raise their hand if they heard of the end of term project? So, okay. So let me just, this was a nice clip from Dallas that talked about it.
Well, once the president-elect is sworn into office, current President Barack Obama will move on to a more personal life. But everything he's done during his 8 years as commander-in-chief is being preserved. And the University of North Texas has stepped up to help archive the president's digital footprint. Here's NBC5's Courtney Gilmore.
The team of researchers will be going through all federal websites ending in .gov, .mil, and .org. So we've compiled a list. There are about 6,000 of them. These are some of them right here. The team wants to gather all of this content, collect it, and then put it in an archive, a place, a database where people can search in the future. Now, they are on deadline. You see this number right here. But when it gets down to zero, that's when President Obama will leave office. Their fear is that when he leaves, all of the web content from his administration will leave with him. The collection is called the End of Term Archive. Researchers are not only collecting data from any website ending in .gov, but also sites like the Affordable Care Act and the DREAM Act, which are two programs that may undergo vast changes or could be obsolete under President-elect Donald Trump. A group of about 10 to 12 partners around the country start planning 8 months before the transition of power takes place. There are three institutions that collect and archive the content: Internet Archive in California, the Library of Congress in D.C., and the University of North Texas. The content gives insight as to how broadly the federal government is involved in every area of our lives. Some scientists and doctors are worried information about climate change and research on health and pollution from the previous administration will be wiped away when Trump heads to the White House. They're asking this question.
What's going to happen with the new administration? There's a lot of angst in certain parts of the community, and there's a lot of really good energy that's going into trying to identify like climate data, environmental data that may be at risk. It's just a really great research collection we're bringing in. It's unique. It's something that if we didn't do it, no one else would.
So the clock is ticking. You see, they have it down to the very second. You know, I told you about those 6,000 websites they have to go through. Well, there are over 10,000 federal government social media sites to archive all of those. They had to add on another partner. George Washington University will be heading up that feat. If you want to go back and search the archive for previous administrations, I put a link on our website at NBCDFW.com. Courtney Gilmore, NBC 5.
Okay, so that was the end of term archive in a nutshell. What's really interesting about that report is that it's a good summary, it's well said, but it's a little bit too rosy, pie-eyed about how clear the end of term project was going to work. They were kind of like, this is the group, they're going to get it done, and there you go. I found out about the end-of-term project at a AALL meeting in July of 2016. The fellow from UNT spoke at the meeting, and I thought that it was such a neat effort, and especially with the incoming administration that was talking about changing things pretty drastically, there was even more of a passion for the end-of-term archive. I got on their listserv, and I started to sort of see how their workflow worked and what their plan was. And I'll talk more about the end of term, but it's definitely a small, a very, very small but mighty group with a lot of knowledge about this space. But it's such a huge space that the website space is so vast and so big and so not in just a list that you could find if you were looking for print titles. But when you're trying to look for website listings of .gov that change their names or add two or three websites, it's just so overwhelming that it's not, they did an exponentially better job in 2016 than they had done for the previous two times that they were at the end of term. But it's not clear that they captured everything. And there was one partner, George Washington, who worked on social media, but it's unclear on how much they could potentially capture either. So this is the group that worked on the end of term 2016, and I highlight that they were all volunteers. This is something that I was surprised that my colleagues weren't aware of. Even in that report from the Dallas News where they talked about these institutions, you think that there's some sort of funding stream, you think that there's a workflow that's just set maybe from a government source. But no, it's all volunteers, which is really extraordinary. The reason that it's all volunteers and that there's not really a workflow is that there aren't really clear rules yet. So the National Archives and Records Administration sets the schedules for each agency about what and when they provide their materials, their documents to NARA. Only in 2014 did NARA begin releasing those records of schedules so that you would know as a public person what to expect to find from Agency X. And on top of all this, there is no schedule which defines really clearly what agency website material, that defines agency website material as a record. So if you can imagine, it's really a wild, wild west of what materials go online on agency websites, and what materials NARA is able to capture and grab. Rebecca Kunkel from Rutgers wrote a pretty short but scholarly update on some of the issues with foreign digital government information and the fact that it's not clear what information you're going to be able to find, because the way of documenting, indexing, titling online information is not the same as it was when it was created in print. I highlight the Sunlight Foundation for putting together a couple years ago these lists of takeaways for what data should be public from the government, how to make data public from the government, and how to implement this policy. And the major players know about these suggestions, these ideas, but again, this is not, the Sunlight Foundation is not a governmental authority, but there's a lot of people talking in this space right now. But I would like to highlight that there's nothing set in stone. There's no clear workflow with lots of funding resources for saving government data. It's a little bit mind-blowing if you're not aware of that fact. So back in December or so, with the idea behind me that I've always wanted to do a hackathon, I even at one point, at least a year ago, I spoke with Ravel about doing a hackathon, and Ravel was really nice. They were like, sure, you can figure out what you think you could do, we'd be glad to help. But I just did not have the deep computer skills to really come up with a hackathon. But I think the end of term project really met my desires, because you could use your computer, you could search the internet, you could help do something very practical, very vital, and you just needed a form. And the form was created by UNT. I'm going to be talking about a couple other organizations who created similar sort of deposit forms. And in a nutshell, basically what you're doing with this preservation of data advocacy, this information saving advocacy that I'm talking about, is you're going online and you're finding government data that you believe is valuable. You're saving URLs in a form similar to this, and then in the top right, you see that orange submit button, add a URL. That's all that the user is doing. So it's your technology skills can be pretty low, and you can see maybe just quickly how collaborative this could be. So end of term for 2016, it happens every 4 years, and that was the third rendition of the end of term group. And they started, I would say, in the summer of 2016 marketing what they do. And then about that same time, two other groups sort of popped up. One's called EDGI, Environmental Data and Governance Initiative, and they're based out of Boston, Harvard. There's a lot of physicists at Harvard that are part of EDGI. And then you've got another group called Data Refuge, and some of the key players in Data Refuge were professors at the University of Pennsylvania. So those were sort of the locations for those organizations. EDGI has a lot of knowledge about government agency architecture for their websites, and they've put together some really good online toolkits of how you can go through an agency website and start to figure out how it's put together and how to save data. And they've explained pretty clearly, they have videos, they have training lessons, how you would go about saving different types of data, and I'll talk about that in a second. But they had a lot of partners who did things like guerrilla archiving, and Edgy linked up with the Data Refuge folks. Data Refuge is really good at marketing, and these folks are really passionate about environment, climate change. They did a mass crowdsource effort for saving EPA statistics and data sets. So this was my slide to try to help gather the different groups that were in this space from summer of 2016 and still currently working now. So I sort of put the end of term folks sort of at the beginning, but that may be semantics. At the same time, there was the end of term folks. There was another organization, Edgy, and another one, Data Refuge. They all work with the Internet Archive. The Internet Archive is fundamental to all of these online data rescue efforts. And I like to say with the timeline for the end of term project, it has to have a beginning and an end because it's only in place to save a previous administration's web content before a new administration takes over, has different missions, changes web pages. Because, again, there's no workflow for government websites to preserve their online content, really, unless it's a NARA record, and that's really been hit or miss to this point. So end of term ended in March. They could have ended quite a bit sooner. They could have ended in January, but there was so much interest in end of term that they kept it going. At the same time, so they had a mission of preserving past administrative content. Edgy and Data Refuge, their interest is more in preserving data that is not being updated or is no longer easily accessible to the public. If you think of terms like activism or things like that, I would say like Data Refuge and its interest for the environment and its fear of changes to the EPA, that's sort of where they their space is. And so they worked before January, but in my mind, it helps to say like 2017 and on is when these other groups continue moving. What they do across the country is hackathon style events to scrape data and develop strategies for preservation of this government web content. In my presentation, this is on the CALI schedule. I linked to the Edgy Data Rescue Toolkit because it's incredibly helpful for figuring out how you go about creating your own event if you were interested in doing such a thing. And then Data Refuge on its side, the marketing, the getting the word out, they've established best practices for doing data rescue or preservation. So these groups work together and they have different strengths. Data Refuge also has a proof of concept for preserving and rescuing government data. And then they even have their list of events because they are very crowdsourced. They're very into social media and doing things on a current level online. Here is, this was from last week. This is a map of all the different data rescue events. And these are typically at universities. A lot of undergrads are interested in this. University libraries are interested in this. Not a lot of law schools, though, which is what is a frustration, or I would think that law students, although very, very busy, would be at the forefront of needing to save federal government website information and data. Lots of law firms use statistics from the government, but it's really not in the law school space yet. So here's the face of what I call a save-a-thon event. I'm not sure what the best term for these. Maybe it's data rescue events. Nominate-a-thon was the first term for these events last year. That might be the least good title, but so I'm going to go with save-a-thon right now. But you see, they can be small scale, they can be larger scale. They happen a lot at schools. You need a computer, which I'm like, oh, that's like a hackathon. And you need groups, you need collaboration. This upper left, if you're looking at the screen, is one of my favorite images because this is a public library doing a save-a-thon. Often one-day events, patrons come in to a space, you set up laptops, or if it's students, they bring their own laptop, and you work together to look at government agencies that the user is interested in, and you're saving online content. Sometimes there's training involved. In those different images, you'll see that they might have some PowerPoint slides. But people are working on computers in a collaborative setting. So kind of transitioning now to talk about the nuts and bolts of one of these data rescue events. I started to get really excited about this in December, and I decided, okay, I'll host my own data rescue event at the University of San Diego Law School. So I started talking to folks in December, and then I hosted it on January 17th, right before the inauguration. So I had an instruction sheet, a one-page flyer, and then I had sort of an event posting on our institutional website. You can still access it now, but it's an event that's done. So I linked to that old web page, but basically you need the basics for any event, you know, the time and date, the location, and the details. Another way to do one of these data rescue events, I've seen many types of like Facebook event pages, and this seems to make a lot of sense for undergrads. This was, they called it guerrilla archiving. These were, you know, environmental students in Toronto. They were definitely more on the activist side, but you can simply do a data rescue event just to keep facts available. I highlight this event that was in New York in December. It was so they've got their date, time, venue, the participants. This was the event that got me excited about doing my own event. Debbie Rabina is a librarian. And it got featured in the New York Times, and then the end of term project got featured in multiple different media outlets. And you just sort of felt like you could actually do something to save information, and this was a librarian information professional space. And it's cool, it's exciting, it's very current to be part of a collaborative effort that I don't recall before this effort to save websites, the information was in print. There wasn't really the same need to preserve data as it is currently. These organizations that do data rescue they've evolved a little bit. So you can do that typical type of social interaction where you're saving government web pages, but they also, this is where the rubber is starting to meet the road, and I can see archivists and different types of library groups really talking about metadata. The Internet Archive is a repository for just huge sizes of data, and they don't have like a library catalog set of metadata at this point. So if you know what you're looking for in the Internet Archive, you have a good shot of finding it. But if you didn't know that the Census Bureau put out a data listing in 2012, you might have trouble finding it in the Internet Archive unless people can curate the data. And that's not clear at all how that can work. The University of North Texas has some really good computing skill sets and library skill sets, so they do have a way in which librarians can contribute by just entering a form of the metadata. When they see a web page, they'll complete sort of some basic Dublin Core metadata, submit it, and it helps the Internet Archive, but that's a slog of an effort. And some other ways to work in this space collaboratively is teaching web archiving skills. There's great need for outreach and education. I don't know how many law librarians, legal information professionals are really clear about how crucial the need to save online data is. I've spoken to an incredibly scholarly, intelligent faculty who simply have, this is not their bailiwick. And when I started explaining the end of term, they said, I don't understand, the information's on Google. Everybody knows that you shouldn't put up, you know, embarrassing pictures because they can last forever. So what's the problem with government data? That should last forever. So there's a lot of need for outreach and education, a lot of and letting people know that there is no funding for saving online government websites. And then this was new to me. I never even thought of this, but storytelling, providing like people in social media space, when you have the personal touch and you provide, you have some type of event, and then you have the face of a student who had some particular reason for saving some older agency website pages, that's really compelling. And the storytelling aspect is a really neat area that we can explore more. I have just a couple more slides about why online information should be preserved, why it's difficult to preserve, and what we can think about for the future. So the folks at Data Refuge, so that was the University of Pennsylvania, they are really, really interested in saving government online information, and they realized that their initial push for the environmental site was a good one, and now they want to move on and grow and collaborate with others who might have other interests. So they've created the Libraries Plus Network. That's so current. I think one of its very first meetings was in May in Washington, D.C. The ARL is a part of Libraries Plus Network. And I think this is where we can go in the future if we want to take part in this saving the online space. Something that really hit home to me from an online webinar about saving government information is that you've got to think about, you've got web pages, but you've also got FTP sites. You've got data visualizations, and there's no answer yet for saving data visualizations. And you've got, inside of websites, you can have databases. Multiple examples come to mind of going to a .gov website and then getting some type of database where you can pick something and then you'll get information out of that database. Data sets, databases can be difficult to crawl and archive. So folks are really thinking about preserving the e-space for government information, and they talk about sort of a four-part path where you identify where you should go and what you should collect. You do the collecting. This area that we don't really even touch on because we're trying to get people to save the information is the issue of authenticity. And then you share. You get it in a space where the public can access the information. Otherwise, what's the point? So not to forget or not talk about the Internet Archive and the Wayback Machine and how much the Internet Archive has contributed to this space. It's a nonprofit organization, not related to the government at all. It's kind of amazing the work that they do and the collaborations that they've built. Along with the Internet Archive, the Internet Archive has a system called Heritrix that does whole site archiving. And that's what was used for the end of term and some of the edgy and dot data refuge projects. So the whole site archiving system, basically, you'll put in a URL. At the end of the URL, it could be, you know, site. It could be epa.gov/something-something/site.php or something like that. And then if you have a nice overarching URL, then Heritrix can go in and look at all the links off of that URL. It only goes so deep, though, in a site. And some of these .gov websites are many, many levels deep. So it can be very tricky to crawl a .gov site. Another type of technology is a single-page archiving system. Folks might be familiar with perma.cc. It can capture a single page and save it in the perma.cc servers, which is great, but it doesn't do that whole site archiving that really helps. So when you look at an old .gov site and you click on an old link, that you're able to go to where that link went. And then there's another set of technology called a data scraping system. And then there's some new sources that are working also in this space. Okay, so I have two last slides. This one is very useful in lessons learned when you're creating your own event. So you need to think about the timing of the event. If you're in a law school, I ran into problems in December. It was finally jammed, so there was that would have been a terrible time to have an event. And then I had the wall of the inauguration, and so I needed to do the event before the inauguration, but students had just come back from the winter, so it wasn't the best time. I can do another data rescue event that is not tied to a change of administration, and I could try to figure out what would be a good time for my students. Thinking about where you're going to collaborate for your event. Are you going to have it in a big space, in an open space? What kind of access to computers do your users have? Some of the most difficult parts of any one of these events is explaining it. Hopefully I explained data rescue well today, but it took me a little bit. It's really hard to take 5 minutes of somebody's time, explain the value of saving government websites, explaining that no one's doing it, explaining how saving government websites works, explaining that Google doesn't save websites, and so on and so forth can be kind of tricky. That's why I linked to the Data Rescue Toolkit and some marketing resources, because this has come up time and time again, so you really don't need to reinvent the wheel, but that is something to think about that you might need to work on, really knowing what you're talking about to help students or patrons understand why they're doing it. Once they start going online, looking at .gov websites, it starts to make sense. Being upfront about your expectations. People really don't want to do this wrong. They don't want to duplicate efforts. This is such a chaotic experience with volunteers that there's no way that you're not going to duplicate efforts. So I try to say up front that duplicating efforts is fine. It gets figured out on the back end by folks at, you know, the Internet Archive and UNT, so don't worry about it. If you're at an institutional environment, really getting buy-in, even like a step beyond buy-in. Like, people think preserving data is good, but they may not understand what it might take to develop one of these events unless you really can even like have them test it out, and then your supervisor might say, wow, this is really cool. Snacks for preparation for the event. Snacks are always very, very good. Marketing is really key. Remember to reserve a space. What I found at my law school, because of I think the law student culture, and it could vary tremendously across the country, but the lack of time, the need for bars credit, the need to do intern work, doing these sort of fun one-off events is like at the bottom of a law student's understanding. And I had one faculty member who gave extra credit for students to do this, and that was enough value for the students to try it. Once they tried it, they really liked it. They liked being part of something that was doing something valuable, but they were not going to do it without having some benefit and value for their time. Knowing what I know now, I would get much more faculty buy-in, much more extra credit involved with doing these events. Fielding questions during the event, you're going to get users asking you for guidance as they get started. You'll get some more difficult questions as participants get the idea of the event and they find data visualization, or they find databases and they're like, can this be archived? The end of term volunteer group got lots and lots of questions throughout the months of their project about like what can be crawled, what should be saved, what is the best place to start in a .gov site. What the event is done, you did great, people showed up, it was an exciting collaboration effort, and then what next? Was that it? Or should you do this on an ongoing basis? I'm just working myself through this process, so I think I would definitely do this for the next end of term project, but it does take a bit of timing to get this going. So my last thoughts regarding issues unique to saving website information. Centralization of access to information is really helpful for these .gov websites. I mean, there's over 200 agency websites, and I think I might even be lowballing that number. And the issue of if there's a number of data rescue events across the country and everybody's focused on the EPA is going to get saved for sure. But there's 199 other agencies to think about and save. So there's an issue of figuring out how all these volunteer groups can work together, and that's how Libraries Plus Network, it can be helpful to say, okay, you have an expertise in this, and you have an expertise in that, so let's expand our resources. After people figure out the way in which they're going to save .gov websites, then figuring out how to authenticate what they have, either on their servers because they're Stanford, or in the Internet Archive, how do you know that was FBI.gov and not another organization's copying of FBI.gov and then maybe changing it for whatever reason to add more information or something. We still have an issue of non-crawlable items on our site. And then I bring up the issue of fugitive documents because that's one of the reasons that you need to save .gov sites is because they're born digital items that aren't part of records and they're just online. And if you can save them in that .gov site, then you're gonna be able to preserve them. A last thought is that the DPO is accepting partnerships in this space. So if you have a big library and you're really excited, you could become a direct partner with the DPO. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah.
What's a data visualization?
So those are kind of like, if you think of just even a map or something that takes the basic Excel spreadsheet and puts it into something that you can quickly see in a visual way. So maps or sort of heat graphs and things like that, you can't really preserve those well.
So is the issue with that that they're not able to save the images themselves?
So that's a really good question. I just heard it and I was like, oh, that makes sense. I think the image is more that those data visualizations are like databases and they change as the underlying data changes. And so you can't save that changing, moving visualization, but you could just save like the image of whatever was current when you see it. But maybe it's bigger than just the screen. Maybe you can look at New York and then you can look at California and yeah.
I just have a couple of comments.
Oh yeah, thank you.
First off, it was great. I think, I was really involved from, like, UELMA in Washington.
Okay.
And so one of the challenges I had was just sort of convincing people that we should go back and do something, you know, to actually authenticate and ensure that things are trustworthy. And that's kind of, it's sort of hard to ring that bell, right? Like, 2 years without the fax number and on Google. And so it's just sort of, like, a difficult topic to educate people about. And so you have that challenge, and then, like you said, you have the challenge of law students being really busy, and it's sort of it's a tough battle because I'm not even sure they're always aware of what we're doing as law librarians, so it's like a great marketing opportunity to get them involved. But have you considered doing this and engaging the university more broadly, or maybe stepping outside of the university? Because I wonder what would happen if you enlarged your scope of people.
That's a great reminder. When I got really excited in December, I ran to the veterans. There's a veterans group on campus that basically serves undergrad. And they were intrigued, but it was a bad time of year, and I wanted it to mesh with law students. And also, we have a sister undergrad library. Their students weren't even going to be there in January. And so I had that thought, and then I forgot about it because I needed it for a certain timing, but now that you mention it, in the future, I would absolutely, because just the amount of support from undergrad is amazing, and I think it would help law students to say, like, hey, what are you missing? Like, there's a big surge here. Yeah, I think that's a great point.
It's almost like you need, I don't know, like a younger group of people to kind of buy into this idea,
yeah.
And then, you know, and yeah, I think like maybe it would come to law school and if they saw you doing this.
It's definitely a slog.
It's interesting though. I mean, kudos to you for trying something that's so hard to do and trying to engage them in different ways.
Well, and it was fun. It was really fun. And you're actually doing something that's as close as I'll ever get to a hackathon, you know? And and it does engage. Once they sat down at computers, we might have had maybe 15 law students because of the extra credit, and they were like, what is this? And then they're like, oh, hey, did you see that at the .gov web? That's cool, we should save that. You know, so, yeah. Well, thank you guys very much for coming.
blanking.